through that door. It's like we have to close ranks.
So often it's like, why? How did this happen? How could this happen? You're telling me that this many people knew this? You're telling me that he married Aaliyah and, you know, that this tape was circulating in barbershops and not, like, how? How?
This doesn't happen without a symphony of people and industries and organizations and corporations enabling this behavior.
What's good? Oh, gang, 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 gang. So, day two, R. Kelly has just ended. It's always ending so late. It's approximately 11:12 p.m. And so, of course, I have to do my review after it's over because I have to watch the entire thing. But it started with the first album with Geronda Pace. And Geronda Pace is a girl that did not have a father in her life, and her mother could care less about anything she did, even if she ate. And that really touched me, because a lot of us were blaming the parents, like, these parents are just giving these kids to this man, and they don't care about their kids because they just letting them go with this man just so that they could get money or that they could be singers themselves. But Geronda Pace was just a fan, and she didn't have any parents that were actively involved in her life. That really touched me. Then we have Lanitra the Braider. Lanitra did not have intercourse with R. Kelly, which was shocking to hear. And Lanitra was molested several times in her life. And so R. Kelly forcing her to perform oral sex was like her breaking point. And she definitely ran to authorities and did the right thing. She was a mother of three, and she felt like he forced her to do that. And so she took action. And it didn't say how much she, because they did not charge him criminally. But that's the thing with most victims, they don't charge these people with criminal, but they take them to civil court and they try to get money for these victims. And so they gave her money, but they didn't say exactly how much did she get. The same things with Hawkins. Hawkins got $250,000. What's interesting is all of them were told to go to Susan's office, a lawyer on TV, and she pushed under the rug a lot of the young girls that R. Kelly was sleeping with by making them sign non-disclosures, and also by making them get some money and just to shut up, like, and let it go away. What I also found interesting was that Geronda said he hates women, and she feels he hates women because of his molestation and because he always keeps saying his mom wasn't there to protect him. But in an interview way back in the day of R. Kelly, he praises his mother. He said he had a crush on his mother. He said he loved his mother, like, in a sexual fashion. And so it's kind of weird that he hates women, but with most sexual encounters that you don't agree to or consent to, you definitely have some ill feelings towards the opposite sex of that person, or who, or even if it's the same sex, you have an ill feeling towards that sex. A lot of these girls got PTSD. Geronda says she had a suicide pact. A lot of these girls have seizures, have just lifelong, forever long emotional problems. And so I hurt for them. I really do. I really do. Dominique, I was waiting to hear from her. Dominique was rescued by her mother, and that rescue made me cry. It makes me cry right now because her mother really loves her. And you know when your parent really loves you, you know. And Dominique went back 3 days later, and I couldn't understand. Like, I heard about it, and I was like, she what? Her mom rescued her, got her out of there, and she went back. And Dominique explains that she wanted to leave because she wanted to leave. She didn't want to leave because somebody was making her leave. And she didn't stay long, even though she was with him a total of 9 years. Geronda is the one that introduced Dominique to R. Kelly. But it wasn't like a proper introduction. It was just, oh, I could bring my friend and he'll call her for me. Because he wouldn't let her call. And he just never let them speak. The guy, Steve Greenberg, who is R. Kelly's lawyer, keep continuously saying that these girls just want money. These girls are here to set him up. These girls are all lying. Everybody is lying. But what I really truly loved about Dominique, she didn't talk much, but she said she left for her brother. And so I just love that. I love that you really could love your family over anybody, because family's everything. And because of her brother, she left. And I'm proud of you, Dominique. I don't know if you ever will watch this video, but I'm proud of you. Valencia Love bails R. Kelly out, $100,000. A lot of comedians, they were bringing that up a lot. A lot of comedians like Dave Chappelle and a bunch of comedians on SNL and things like that. They always made jokes about R. Kelly and how he's the pee guy and pee jokes. And so it kind of diminishes that is a rape or that he's hurting a child. It's more like, ha ha ha, he's a freak, he's a perv, and they make a joke out of it. And so I'm glad that they touched on that a little bit. Then they had Haley Calhoun. Haley is a white girl who was with him for 3.5 years during the time of Dominique Azrael and currently Jocelyn. Or Joycelyn, and she says that one day they got into an altercation over a text or her looking at a man, and he broke her chain and all kind of stuff. And somebody who's blurred out in the video said he choked her out and really put his hands on her, left marks. She's white, so of course she had a bunch of marks and scratches. And then it ends with he's being charged like a mobster. Several counts, many, many states. And his ship is sinking, as they quote it. I just want to touch on real quick how Dominique said one day they got into an altercation. She was the rebellious one. She wouldn't really listen to his rules. And one day they got into an altercation and he pulled all her hair out. If you look at the pictures of Dominique before and now, now Dominique looked like a butch, looked like a dude. Before, she was a girly girl, pressed hair, real pretty. So the fact that he was starving her, locking her up, showing her no love, showing her rebellious self to be somebody he just want to whoop on and beat on, and to take it as far as ripping her hair out of her scalp and making her bald-headed. and then treating her like a boy. And then she didn't want to talk about it. That really hurts. That really hurted me. I could imagine, I was saying it yesterday on my last reaction, that he must treat her like a boy because he wanted her to look like a boy. And I couldn't imagine, I can't imagine what she went through for nine long, long years. I'm sorry you went through that, baby girl.
All of a sudden, have R. Kelly choose you. It was a high for me. It was like the highlight of my life. Like, you don't understand. Like, this is R. Kelly. He chose me. Nobody in my life had valued me. You know, when I graduated, nobody showed up for my graduation. And it was like,
no, Dad.
I was always
the only one. Mom didn't care about
her. I was always looked over. And Rob, he just treated me so much better than, you know, my family had treated me.
Wow. Austin. All right, so I want to touch on some things that I personally have gone through. I wrote it in my book, Living Life, Not Just Alive. I touched on it a little bit in my autobiography book. If y'all don't know, y'all could go check that out on BarnesandNobles.com or Amazon.com. It's called Living Life, Not Just Alive. But when I was 16, going on 17, it was my birthday. I went out to the movies with a boyfriend I had at the time. He fell asleep on the train. And long story short, I told him to go home. I would be good. I could get home. So I left the train station by myself and I waited for a bus. And the bus was taking too long. And I was waiting too long and my feet was hurting. And so I started walking home. And I lived in the projects in the Bronx. And when I went home, I was a building away from my building when a stranger grabbed and choked me and put me behind a store in an alley. And he tried to rape me and he sodomized me. And I never been molested or touched by family members, thank God. So it being a stranger was more of a feeling of, will he let me live? Please let me live. I had just had my son in March. This happened in September. So it was about 6 months. My son was 6 months. And I just wanted to live, you know. I just wanted to live. And a lot of what happened, going to the hospital in the ER and getting home and calling for the police, and a lot of what happened, I don't remember. I just know that I called the police. I called my mom. I know that I got to the hospital. I know that they did do a rape kit. I know that my case was closed because I couldn't identify a face. And I know that I never received justice. I'm not the first. It's like out of 10 girls, every seven, eight girls have been molested or raped. It's like high numbers. This been going on since slavery times, since way back in the day. And so, it is very true that I did try to press criminal charges, but I couldn't remember a face. And so then my lawyer, he did try to get me a civil suit against the location, the store owners, and, you know, the store. And I did a deposition, and I remember being questioned, interrogated. And I remember not remembering a lot because I was choked out. You know, and I was blacking out and I just couldn't remember a lot. And so I just, I never got any money behind what happened to me neither. And so I never got any justice all the way around. Yeah, I'm a color woman. Yeah, I was by the projects, raised in the projects. And yeah, it was a Spanish man. That's all I knew. I wish I would have got justice. So, yesterday, I said I didn't want R. Kelly to go to jail. But today, I'm saying that if those girls see him going to jail, it could kind of help them to heal. And it will really help them to know that they got some kind of justice for what had happened to them.
That's the day I left from the hotel to leave my mother. My room gave this call from the front desk lady, and she said, "You have a package downstairs." And I was just like, "Okay, cool. Can you just bring it up? Because I can't go downstairs and get it." So a few seconds later, I get a knock at the door, and then it's my mother with a camera crew.
Please,
and that was like the hardest decision I had to make, because of course I love Rob. But then again, I knew that the situation wasn't good. Joyce Lynn was there in the room. Her door was closed, so she did not let out. And I felt bad for leaving her, because it was like we was all we had. So, it's tough.
All right, guys. So the last thing I want to touch on is women and what we think is love. A lot of times I see a lot of movies where women are getting beat and they stay and they love the guy and they feel like, oh, he loves me. I've met people in real life that have been beaten by men and they felt like they couldn't leave. They were scared to leave. And a lot of times they didn't want to leave because they loved the person. And I could never understand in my mind how you could say somebody who's beating on you that is not your dad or your mother could really, really love you. Like how could you believe that? And then you have a whole fear factor. If I leave, he's going to kill me, or if I leave. You know, and then I met at church when I was in, I do a lot of stage plays. I met the opposite roles, and the guy was getting beat by the lady, and he was in a marriage, and he divorced her. He's remarried, happily married now, but he was getting beat by his wife, and people thought he was a punk, like, oh, you let her beat on you, but she was really abusive. So, I mean, it happens to both sexes. And it's not right, and it's not love. And I just really hope that as time is going on and millennials are getting wiser and these kids are growing up and they're knowing way more than what we knew back in the day, that they realize that love is not pain. Love is not envy. Love does not voice. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love endures all things. Hopes all things, is loyal, it uplifts you, it makes you feel good, but most importantly, love is God. So if you don't see God in what's happening to you, it's not love. And I've just been blessed that I did have semi-domestic violence relationship, but it wasn't bad, thank God. It was never like he blacked my eye, he slapped my face. It was never like that. But, you know, I did have some kind of violence in my relationship. And I did love him. And so I kind of went through that. But not to the extent of a lot of women. And so I'm glad that we get out of it and we get wiser and we get smarter. And you just know that that's not love. Love is God. And if you don't see God in what you have, it's not love. Especially if you see God, then you love yourself. And you love yourself enough to not be treated any other way than good. So I wanted to touch on that. I also wanted to touch on the fact that it takes, there's no amount of money that could take away your pain. There's no amount of money that can fix you emotionally. There's no amount of money that can make you feel like anything you've gone through in your life is worth that amount of money. And so with R. Kelly paying off these people, I think his biggest payoff was that pee tape. He paid that girl $2 million and her family. So I know to this day, because that girl was with him for years. He peed on her. She was 13, 14. He was with her till she was 21. That's 7, 8 years. So I know that wherever that girl is, she's still healing emotionally. And them $2 million did not heal that. And so I just want to end this video by saying, dear God, protect us. Keep us uplifted. Keep us safe. Keep us wise. Keep us encouraged. God, you know, it's sad that it's a black man doing this to black women. And it's sad that white men and white women don't think he's doing anything wrong. You know, and at the end of the day, I'm not looking for an R. Kelly song. I'm not buying an R. Kelly song. But I know every song. And the crazy thing is, I went to a big Funk Fest festival a few years ago. And he was headline. And when I tell you people from 10 years old to 60, 70 year olds, everybody was jamming to his songs. I'm talking about everybody knew his songs. And music just makes you feel good. It makes you, it puts you in the mood. It just makes you happy. It talks about your feelings. And music is just for the soul. And he has penetrated so many souls with music. And to be this dark, evil man behind closed doors is devastating. So I look forward to talking to you guys again for day three tomorrow, as we get closer and closer to getting Azriel, is her name, Azriel and Joycelyn Joy, helping them to be free. And I love you guys. And if y'all like this video, like, comment, subscribe. And if y'all relate to me, if y'all disagree with me, anything, comment down below. I love you guys. And I'm out.